السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأصلي وأسلم على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، نبينا وحبيبنا وقرة أعيننا محمد بن عبد الله، عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم. أما بعد، فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في قرآنه العزيز بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الرحمن علم القرآن، خلق الإنسان علمه البيان، الشمس والقمر بحسبان، والنجم والشجر يسجدان، والسماء رفعها ووضع الميزان. صدق الله العظيم. All praise and thanks be to Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is our creator, sustainer, nourisher and protector. May the choicest of his blessings and salutations be upon our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his family members, his companions, and all those who tread upon his path with utmost sincerity until the day of Qiyamah. My dear special elders and brothers in Islam, we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he has given us an opportunity to continue in this great science of his glorious names and attributes. In the last session, we still with the names Ar-Rahman and Ar-Rahim. This is the third session. The very first session, we discussed a few ayat from Surah Ar-Rahman, which discussed the aspects of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the previous session, we discussed about Wa'ibadur Rahman, the qualities of the slaves of the Ar-Rahman, of the Most Merciful. Today's session, inshallah, we'll go further with, I'm actually trying to focus on one ayah, وَالسَّمَاءَ رَفَعَهَا وَوَضَعَ الْمِيزَانِ. But before I go into that ayah, I would like to touch a few things on the previous ayah. So we said that Ar-Rahman, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he starts off the surah by saying that he is the most merciful. Whilst Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could have started off saying هُوَ الرَّحْمَانِ or اللَّهُ الرَّحْمَانِ, that Allah is the most merciful or he is the most merciful. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala started off the surah by saying الرَّحْمَانِ, to show us that there's nothing other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is the most merciful. He's just talking about his mercy. And like I mentioned in the previous session, every single ayah in this beautiful surah relates back to the ayah number one. All of the ayat in the surah relate back to the words Ar-Rahman. In other words, every ayah is talking about the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we also highlighted that we, our lives, every single aspect of our lives by themselves and everything around us is basically permeated in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are wallowing in an ocean of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Every single thing. So the second ayah afterwards, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, عَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنِ. عَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنِ, that he taught the Qur'an. And then the third ayah, خَلَقَ الْإِنسَانِ. Now in the order of the ayat, we can come to a conclusion, and the scholars of tafsir, they mention, عَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنِ خَلَقَ الْإِنسَانِ. He brought about the Qur'an, it is the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and afterwards, he created mankind. Mankind was second. The Qur'an was brought about first. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he placed the Qur'an first and then afterwards created the mankind. And the Qur'an by itself, the speech of Allah, Allahu Akbar, it is the greatest mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon us. We being non-Arabs, we cannot fully appreciate the miracle of the noble Qur'an. Because the beauty of the Arabic which is used in it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the noble Qur'an at a time to the lands of Arabia when poetry was at its peak. Poetry was at its peak. Let me give you all one incident to highlight the beauty or the miraculous characteristics of the noble Qur'an. There was an individual named Walid ibn Mughira. Walid ibn Mughira. He was a great poet. And once again I say, this was a time when poetry was the thing at that time. they were so eloquent, the Arabs, they used to give out verses of poetry which if it reached a certain level, they used to hand these verses or these odes of poetry in the Kaaba. There were 7 odes of poetry hung in the Kaaba known as Mu'allaqat al-Saba'. 7 odes of poetry which were so eloquent and so beautiful. So it was at this time that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the noble Qur'an. So when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam started reciting the verses of the noble Qur'an, the Arabs were baffled. The Arabs were baffled. But the Quraysh, they did not have it in them, even though they knew Rasulullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he is the most truthful. And he has come with the truth. But it was their asabiyya, it was their fanaticism, which they were following the idols and the gods of their fathers and their forefathers. They did not want to leave that. They were stubborn, they were arrogant. But they knew that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if he is saying something, then there has to be something to it. So when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam started reciting the ayat, they were baffled. And now I'm talking about Walid ibn Mughira. He was considered as the Shakespeare of their time, Walid ibn Mughira. And perhaps you could even say that he could have even been more intelligent than Shakespeare, Walid ibn Mughira. So the Quraysh, they go to Walid ibn Mughira and they say, you know, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he is reciting verses of poetry. You have to come and listen to it and give us your opinion in regard to it. So Walid ibn Mughira, a famous person, an important person, he said, okay, fine, I'll come. But let's go in a way that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would not identify us as becoming to listen to him. Rather, let's eavesdrop on him and let's see what he has to say. Then they go to perhaps a gathering of where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was seated, or perhaps to his house, and they eavesdrop. The narration goes on to say that Walid ibn Mughira, the Shakespeare of that time, the greatest poet of that time, he was on his camel. The minute the verses of the noble Quran fell on his ears, he basically fell off his camel. Walid ibn Mughira fell off his camel, literally fell off his camel, because he was astounded. He looked at the people of the Quraysh and he said to them, Ya Ahla Quraysh, you know something? These words are out of this world. In other words, this is some kind of magic, but it is not the magic that we know about. This is not from Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why? Because it was also from the infinite wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he kept our beloved Prophet, a person who could not read nor write. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam could not read nor write. The reason being so that no one could come later on and say that perhaps Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam concocted the Quran or he came up with the Quran. No, these words were above human product. You know, no human could produce such words. It was impossible. And the Arabs, they knew of it because they had reached such high levels of eloquency in the Arabic language. If you talk about the smallest surah in the noble Quran, Inna a'tainaka al-kawthar fasalli li rabbika wanhar inna shani'aka huwa al-abtar. 3 verses, almost approximately around 10 words. But scholars of tafsir, they go on to write, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, almost up to 16 different rhetoric styles are hidden within the surah. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Impossible. No human can come up with even 3 verses which would have the same 16 rhetoric styles, just as how that surah has. Allahu Akbar. It is impossible. So they were baffled, they were astounded. And they knew that this was a miracle. This is a divine book. It is a divine revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But it was their stubbornness, it was their pride that did not allow them to accept the message, to come into the fold of Islam. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala starts off saying, عَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنِ, that He taught us the noble Qur'an. The great mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A manual for us to conduct our lives. We say that Allah is one, the message is one, all of the books are one. We believe in the Torah of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. We believe in the sons of David, Dawood alayhi salatu wasalam. We believe in the Bible of Jesus, Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. We believe in Injil of Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, and the Torah of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. But today, what we ask the followers of Christianity or the followers of Judaism is, can you bring the original manuscript? Can you bring the original form of your revelation? No, they can't. No, they can't. The Bible has so many versions, old version, new, Old Testament, New Testament. We have so many versions. The reason being, man has changed that message. Man has tampered with it, altered it, brought in new things, deleted some things that he did not like. Unlike the noble Quran, not one letter has moved from its place. In this very gathering, if I were to recite an ayah wrong, perhaps there would be one or two from the Hufadh al-Quran who would be able to immediately correct me. They would be able to correct me. Because this is the miracle, this is the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, likewise the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He would protect His word. He would protect it. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through time, 1400 years ago, until now, Allah the Almighty has been protecting the noble Quran. It has been memorized by Hufadh all over the world. Allahu Akbar. So this is the divine revelation, the final revelation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which has been sent to us as a great mercy. خلق الإنسان. The next ayah. He says that He created mankind. So you see, then just reciting the ayat when we read the noble Quran, it is up to us to sit, contemplate and ponder on each ayah. You say خلق الإنسان, He created mankind. Okay, fine, let's go to the next verse. No. Think, we are in Surah Ar-Rahman. How does this ayah connect to the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? He creating us, giving us life. This is one of the greatest mercies of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahu Akbar. And how did He create us? He created us upon the fitrah, the natural human disposition, where we are sinless. And we are not held accountable until the age of buluh, until the age of maturity. Until the age of maturity, you're not held accountable for the wrongdoings that you commit. Unlike the beliefs of the Christians, they have a belief known as the original sin. The original sin, where they say, according to that belief, Adam alayhi salatu wasalam committed a wrong. He committed a sin, and that has been passed on through our ancestry onto every one of us. The whole race of mankind, they say, we are born upon sin. We are on sin. We are not sinless. This is their belief. But Islam teaches us no. We are born on the fitrah. We are sinless. And from our maturity, from buluh, it depends on the choices that we make. And afterwards, we are held accountable for our deeds. We are held accountable for our deeds. Now, in regard to what Adam alayhi salatu wasalam did, that is between him and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay, a question. Are prophets sinless? Are prophets sinless? Many of the scholars, such as Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, and other scholars, the majority of the scholars, what they say is, the Anbiya alayhim salatu wasalam, they are free from kaba'ir. They are free from major sins. They would never ever commit a major sin. Likewise, in regard to their duty, in regard to the message that they are propagating, they would not commit a mistake. But in regard to their own judgment, in this worldly life, and also minor things, there is a possibility that they might commit them. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives them. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, he goes on to list a few instances. Number one, primarily Adam alayhi salatu wasalam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's order was that you are not supposed to eat from this fruit or from this tree. What did shaitan do? He goes and whispers, and he says, فَقَالَ هَلْ أَدُلُّكُمْ عَلَىٰ شَجَرَةِ الْخُلْدِ وَمُلْكٍ لَا يَبْلَىٰ. He goes and whispers to Adam alayhi salatu wasalam, Ya Adam, shall I show or shall I indicate to you a tree? If you were to eat of that fruit, you would live, you would attain immortality. You would live for an eternity. Likewise, if you eat that fruit, you would achieve or you would get hold of a kingdom that would never be destroyed. Now a question could also arise, how did Shaitan know of this? Or how did he know how to tackle Adam alayhi salatu wasalam? I have mentioned this earlier too. See, Adam alayhi salatu wasalam, he was in Jannah. He has the fear of losing Jannah. He is in Jannah, the places of Jannah, Allahu Akbar. And Shaitan, as Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasalam is reported to have said, Shaitan, وَيَجْرِي فِي مَجْرَ الدَّمِ, he runs in our blood, in our veins. Shaitan runs everywhere. So Shaitan, what he does, he is a sworn enemy. What he does is he studies each and every one of us. He studies us. He studies us and he finds out, okay, this person has a tendency towards this. He has this. He has this in his heart. He has a desire like this. And that's how he traps that individual. That's how he places traps afterwards. Now the intelligent believer, the intelligent mu'min, is the one who studies the strategy of his enemy, of Shaitan, and stays away from those traps. So coming back to Adam alayhi salatu wasalam, he whispers this into Adam alayhi salatu wasalam. What did Adam alayhi salatu wasalam do? We know that he ate of the fruit. فَأَكَلَا مِنْهَا فَبَدَتْ لَهُمَا سَوْآتُهُمَا وَطَفِقَا يَخْصِفَانِ عَلَيْهِمَا مِنْ وَرَقِ الْجَنَّةِ. Both of them, our father and mother, Adam عليه الصلاة والسلام and Hawa عليها الصلاة والسلام, Adam and Eve, فَأَكَلَا مِنْهَا, they ate of it, the apple or the fruit, there's a contradiction in regard to that. فَأَكَلَا مِنْهَا, they ate from it, فَبَدَتْ لَهُمَا سَوْآتُهُمَا, and the minute they ate of it, their privates became apparent. The private parts, in other words, they were filled with shame. They were filled with shame. فَبَدَتْ لَهُمَا سَوْآتُهُمَا وَطَفِقَا يَخْصِفَانِ عَلَيْهِمَا مِنْ وَرَقِ الْجَنَّةِ, and they started to grab at the leaves of Jannah and try to cover themselves up. They were trying to cover themselves up away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They were ashamed. And Allah goes on to say, وَعَصَى آدَمُ رَبَّهُ فَغَوَى. Adam alayhi salatu wasalam disobeyed his Lord. وَعَصَى آدَمُ رَبَّهُ فَغَوَى. And he committed a mistake. He committed a mistake. Instance number one. Instance number two, Dawood alayhi salatu wasalam and Sulaiman alayhi salatu wasalam. We know their father and son. Two ladies came to Dawood alayhi salatu wasalam. He was the king at that time. They come to him. Now what was the story before they come to him was, both of them had two children. This story is narrated by Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu. Hadith is in Bukhari. They come to Dawood alayhi salatu wasalam. Now what happened was, these two ladies had two children who looked alike. These two ladies had two sons who looked alike, and whilst they were playing, a wolf came and took one of the sons away. Now both of the ladies, both of the women, were fighting for the other son, saying, you know, he is my son. The other woman is saying, he is my son. Now to end the dispute, they went to Dawood alayhi salatu wasalam. They went to him and they told him the story. Dawood alayhi salatu wasalam immediately ruled in favor of the older woman. He ruled in favor of the older woman. Now what happened was, they weren't happy. Sulaiman alayhi salatu wasalam was in that gathering in the palace at that time. He said, wait, let me also rule in this. And he says, he asks one of the attendees over at the king's court to bring a sword. And he said, I think what would be fair is if we cut the child in half, if we cut the child in half and give half to one lady and the other half to the other lady. The minute he said this, the older woman cried out, may Allah have mercy on you, don't do that. This child belongs to the younger woman. This child belongs to the younger woman. You know, affection immediately came into her heart and she did not want the child to be killed. So from that we understand, and what happens afterwards, Dawood alayhi salatu wasalam, he falls in prostration and asks forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because he ruled in favor of the older lady. Whilst in reality, that would have been an oppression. The child belonged to the younger lady. The child belonged to the younger lady. So in this we understand that the Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam, there is a possibility that they could commit slight mistakes, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives them. And the other instance is in regard to Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam, where he prays for his son whilst his son was on the fold of kufr. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reprimands him in regard to that and rebukes him. The story is in the Noble Quran. So from this we understand, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, that Now coming back to what I was saying, خلق الإنسان. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created us on the fitrah. This is also from the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But we are not going to spend much time on these ayahs. We're moving to the main ayah. وَالسَّمَاءَ رَفَعَهَا وَوَضَعَ الْمِيزَانِ Allahu Akbar. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وَالسَّمَاءَ رَفَعَهَا The heavens, the skies, we have lifted it. وَوَضَعَ الْمِيزَانِ And we have placed, mizan means a balance. We have placed the balance. This, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, is one of the greatest mercies of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In other words, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is trying to say, Allah is trying to make us understand that He lifted the heavens, and placed the balance of the universe, the balance. Now what is this balance? Like I told you, don't pass by the ayah, contemplate and ponder on each ayah. Now what is this balance? And do we see this balance manifesting itself in our lives? Primarily the scholars of Tafasir, they mention that balance is adl, justice. Balance is justice. And they go on to explain that justice, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most just. And likewise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is commanding us. The next ayah Allah goes on to say that we are not supposed to transgress the balance. We are not supposed to transgress the limit. Likewise, we are not supposed to be unjust. We have to maintain the balance of this universe. We have to maintain the balance of this universe. Shaykhul Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, he says a very powerful statement. He's talking about Darul Kufr. He's talking about the lands of Kufr. He's saying, even, we're not talking about Muslim lands, we're talking about the lands of Kufr. He says, even in a land of Kufr, if justice is upheld, if justice prevails, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses that land, Allahu Akbar. Even a land of Kufr. And then he goes on to say, but on the other hand, a Muslim land, we're talking about the Muslim lands now, in that land, if justice does not prevail, if justice is not upheld, the barakat, the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be taken away. Will be taken away. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about justice primarily. But in other words, we can also see the balance manifesting itself in different ways in our lives. Look at this instance. Once Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was collecting funds for a battle. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was collecting funds for a battle. And at that time, Abu Bakr, Umar radiallahu anhu, he thinks, you know what, this is a chance for me to beat Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. Because there was always a competition, a beautiful competition between Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu and Umar radiallahu anhu. In what? In good deeds. They were competing one another to see who would do better in good deeds. So Umar radiallahu anhu thinks that, okay, I'm going to beat him today. I'm going to beat Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu today. So he goes to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with money. And he places his money in front of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The first thing that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asks Umar radiallahu anhu is, Ya Umar, what did you leave back home? What did you leave for your family? Now look, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, scholars of Tafasir mention this. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is maintaining a balance. He's maintaining a balance. He's saying, don't bring everything and come here. Keep something for your home. Keep something for your family. They need it. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is maintaining a balance. So he asks Umar radiallahu anhu, Ya Umar, what did you leave back home? Umar radiallahu anhu replies, Ya Rasulullah, I left half. I left half of my assets. I left half of my wealth back home for my family and I brought half. Allahu Akbar. Now Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu comes. He comes and he keeps a lot of money in front of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asks him the same question. Ya Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, what did you leave back home? What did you leave for your family? Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu replies, Ya Rasulullah, taraktullaha wa rasoola. Allahu Akbar. He says, I left Allah and His Rasul. I left Allah and my beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for my family. I left only them. Umar radiallahu anhu, he says, Ya Allah, I can never ever beat you, Ya Aba Bakr. There is no way No way that I can beat you. However much I try, eventually you beat me. You beat me. Now the question that we can come up with is, why couldn't Umar radiallahu anhu go back home and bring the remaining half and come and give it to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Scholars mention that, okay, it is sincerity, number one. He's not doing it for show. He's not doing it for show. And primarily what this story highlights, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, is the balance. Umar radiallahu anhu, he knew deep within himself, this is all I can give. Now if I were to go back and bring the other half and also keep it, I'm going to put myself in hardship. I'm going to put myself in hardship. In regard to his iman, we're not undermining Umar radiallahu anhu. We're not putting down Umar radiallahu anhu. No, no way. But Umar radiallahu anhu, he knows that, you know what, each and every one of us, we know our financial situation. We know the balance. We know if we do this, you know, I can only afford a house like this. I can only afford a vacation like this. I can only afford a car like this. You know, every one of us, we will be riding in Mercedes and BMWs. We all know what is the balance we need to maintain. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَوَضَعَ الْمِيزَانِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed that beautiful balance. So Umar radiallahu anhu, he knew that there is no point in me going and trying to bring the other half, because I know the balance that I have maintained in this. And if I strike the balance, that is going to be comfortable for me. Likewise, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, in regard to our spending, we are not supposed to be extravagant, splurge, nor are we supposed to be Scrooges. We aren't supposed to be Scrooges, nor are we supposed to splurge. Islam teaches us to take a moderate stance, even place a balance in that. Don't spend extravagantly. Don't spend on things that are unnecessary. Don't be enslaved by today's brands. Today's brands are enslaving us. The very same pair of shoes, okay, you want a comfortable pair of shoes, go and buy a comfortable pair of shoes. But why do you have to spend $1,000, $1,500 to buy a pair of Louis Vuitton shoes? It's unnecessary. Just to have the LV in the front and to sport the brand. Or why do you have to wear a watch which is over millions? It's unnecessary. It's an extravagance that you're spending on. It is an extravagance because these brands are fooling us. It is the very same linen shirt, but just because it's got a brand, now it's so expensive. The same pair of shoes, just because it has got a brand, now it's expensive. You want a good piece of technology, a good mobile phone, you can spend. Yes, it helps you in your daily tasks. Likewise, you need a good computer, yeah, you spend, it helps you in your tasks. But do you need that gold-plated or that diamond-studded BlackBerry? Does that make sense? No. It's just for show. It's not for yourself. You're not going to sit home and look at each diamond and think, how is this going to help me in my daily tasks? But no, it's for show. It's for show. Islam does not encourage that in any way. In any way. You need a vehicle, you run with four wheels, you don't have to be extravagant even in that. Every single thing, there is a balance. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed that balance, and we are not supposed to transgress that balance. Allahu Akbar. In regard to our food, in regard to what we consume, we are not supposed to overeat. This body is an amana, is a trust from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You can't just say, okay, this is my body, and start chopping up your body. You can't just jump off a building and suicide. This body is a trust given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You have to look after it. Why do scholars say that smoking is haram? Why? Because it's harmful to your body. Some smoke like chimneys, but it is harmful. You are killing yourself slowly. Why do scholars advise the youth against shisha? Today shisha, hookah, or this, whatever they call these things, has become the fad. People spend times in coffee shops, hours and hours till late night, indulging in shisha. You see, people who have researched into that say that perhaps one session of shisha, you're smoking for 1 hour shisha. People say, come on, it's apple flavor, candy flavor, how can it be harmful? It is equivalent to so many packets of cigarettes. Equivalent to so many packets of cigarettes, because you're smoking humid, in the sense wet smoke, which could cause lung cancer, and Allah save us, different types of diseases. Who are we to abuse our bodies, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given as a trust? And in regard to food, look at Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. One third for food, one third for beverages such as water, etc. And one third for air. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam maintained a perfect balance. We're not supposed to be hogs when we see food. We should not just start filling ourselves so much to the extent that you can't wake up the next day. In every single thing, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed a balance, a beautiful balance. For if we were to follow that balance, we would attain success in this world and the hereafter. In regard to happiness and sadness, there are some individuals, for the slightest thing, they become really upset. Likewise, for the slightest thing, or perhaps they got something, a materialistic thing, they are overjoyed. Now the same person who is overjoyed, he goes into levels of euphoria, high stages of happiness, when that particular thing that made him happy was plucked away from him as a test perhaps, he goes into deep valleys of sorrow. Rather, we are supposed to maintain a balance even in our happiness and sadness. There was a scholar named Al-Fudayl ibn Iyad. Al-Fudayl ibn Iyad, a great scholar, Imam. He is the teacher of Imam Shafi'i, rahimahullah too. One of the teachers. His son passed away. Al-Fudayl ibn Iyad, his son passed away. And at the funeral, he's smiling away. Al-Fudayl ibn Iyad, he was smiling away. So a companion who was with him, his friend, he asked him, "Ya Fudayl, is this the occasion to be smiling away? The funeral of your son and you're smiling away?" Fudayl ibn Iyad, rahimahullah, he goes on to explain, "How can I be displeased with the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? I need to be pleased with it. I thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala." Now Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, he commentates on this story by saying, "Is Fudayl ibn Iyad a greater person, or is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam a greater person?" Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's son passed away. And at the time of his death, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his eyes were teary. Bilal radiallahu anhu, he asked, "Ya Rasulullah, you are crying?" Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam goes on to say, "It is the rahmah which I have in my heart. It's my child." And then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam goes on, he speaks to his son who has passed away, saying, "The hearts are heavy, the eyes are tearing, but words which would displease Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would never come from our lips. Allahu Akbar." We aren't going to be displeased with the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But it is fair for you to show your sadness. You being a human being, you have been created to manifest your happiness and your grief and your sorrow. But don't pass the levels, don't break the balance and go into extremes of happiness and grief. Finally, let me mention something interesting and I'll wrap it up. Scholars, likewise the awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they find it easy to identify this balance. They find it easy to identify this balance. They know through perhaps their experience and also their closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to strike the balance and also to identify the balance. Let me give you all a story. It's history basically. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, during his time, there was a huge war waged against the Mughals, against the Tartars. It was at that time when the Tartars were causing so much of corruption, they were invading Muslim land after Muslim land, and now they were targeting Dimishq. They were targeting Damascus. At that time, Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah was not a scholar who spent his life, you know, only advising people or only preaching. No, he was a scholar on the field. He was a scholar who stood in the front lines of jihad. He was a scholar who was imprisoned. He used to look at the tyrant and speak the truth. He did not play games. He did not try to win the hearts of the oppressive rulers. No, this was not Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah. He goes straight to the emperor or the sultan of Egypt, of Misr, and he tells him, "King, if you don't bring your army and defend Dimishq, Damascus, if the Tatars invade Damascus, if Damascus falls, The Muslim empire will gradually fall because Damascus is the front line. So you need to get up, bring your army and let's fight them. The king agrees. The king agrees. And now he advances with Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah at the front. Likewise, some other Muslim armies were also, there were a few disputes they had broken off. Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, he goes and speaks to them and also unites the force against the Tatars. But now, on the day of the battle, it was in Ramadan, second or third of Ramadan, time of Dhuhr, both the armies are going to meet. It was at this time, the Muslim army knew that they were outnumbered. They were outnumbered by a huge difference. The Tatars were so huge, and you know the corruption they caused. They killed millions of Muslims. The Euphrates River, it was flowing black. It was flowing black in color. The reason being, they dumped tons and tons of Islamic knowledge, Islamic books into the river. They used the books as bridges. Allahu Akbar. Scholars of history mention so much of books, libraries of Islamic history, Islamic knowledge was destroyed by these Tatars because they used, you know, Genghis Khan and all of these people, they used the books as bridges to cross the river, and the river, it flowed black in color. So there were a huge number on that day, and Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah at the forefront, he makes a statement. He says, Wallahi, we are going to be victorious today. Wallahi, we are going to be victorious. The Muslim army looks at him and says, Ya Imam, why don't you say inshaAllah? Why don't you say inshaAllah, we will be victorious? Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, he goes on to explain saying, I am saying this because I see it literally in front of me, and I'm not saying it as a probability. I'm not saying that perhaps we may win or not win. Then I have to say inshaAllah. Here I can see it right in front of my eyes. And the reason being, my dear, especially elders and brothers in Islam, he saw the balance. He saw that these kuffar, they were acting as if they were Muslims. Because this is one thing they did in the beginning. They acted as if they were the Muslims and they invaded some of the lands. They were causing so much of corruption. We knew that these few Muslim armies have gathered upon Tawheed, upon the I'la'u kalimatillah. They have come to fight that the word of Allah rises high today, while these kuffar, they are on kufr. They are on kufr. Never will they be victorious today. The Muslim army is going to be victorious today. And with that he utters the statement, Allahu Akbar, because he identified the beautiful balance. He knew the balance Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed in this universe will not be transgressed. Allah will maintain the balance. So he mentions that beautiful statement. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, this is just one ayah. And likewise, there are so many other aspects, but time does not permit to cover all of it. But one ayah. So, this is the miracle of the noble Quran. And this is how scholars have written volumes of tafsir over just one ayah, or perhaps one surah. You can go on talking sessions, because there are so... Each time you open the noble Quran, you can come out with a pearl. Because it is the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The divine revelation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You can come out with a pearl, with a gem, each and every time you read the noble Quran. Allahu Akbar. And this is one of the reasons why it is the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon us. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, it is upon us to contemplate and ponder upon the different aspects of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And likewise, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept our good deeds and forgive all of our sins and fill our hearts with mercy. We're talking about the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Likewise, we need to internalize it. We need to act accordingly. So many ahadith that teach us that we need to show mercy to one another. We need to show mercy to our wives. We need to show mercy to our children. Even there is a balance. Just because he is your child does not mean you can beat him and do whatever it is. It is a trust, it is a balance. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed a balance even in that. Your child is a trust, the way you upbring him, the way you bring him up. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to fill our hearts with mercy. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive all of our sins. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept our good deeds. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to unite us in the gardens of Jannah, just as how He united us tonight. So with that we conclude. وآخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين.